Hi everybody, I wanted to do a lesson here today on conjugation and UV-Vis spectroscopy. So one of the things that starts to come up in second semester organic chemistry is when you get to the subject of conjugation, especially with dienes, trienes, and aromatic compounds, there's usually talk of UV-Vis spectroscopy and how conjugation can affect that. So I wanted to kind of give like a brief primer video on how the two are connected and why we see the connections that we do when we're looking at that. So to get started, what is conjugation? In most undergraduate courses, conjugation is taught as you're looking for some sort of alternating double, single, double bond pattern. So for instance, with a diene, you can see double bond, single bond, double bond, right? For an aromatic, you can see the alternating double, single, double, single, double in the ring. Okay, now just keep in mind there are other factors that go into classifying something as aromatic. It's not just looking for the overlapping p orbitals. But that leads to the next point, which is that conjugation is best defined as when you have alignments of p orbitals that are continuous and they allow for overlapping of the pi electrons. So these pi electrons that make up the double bonds that we see here, they can be delocalized over these large stretches of p orbitals that are in alignment with one another. So continuous p orbital overlap for delocalization of pi electrons, that's what really leads to conjugation. And just a side note here, conjugation is different than hyperconjugation. There are some minor similarities in terms of overlap and the ability to basically share electrons. However, those are two separate subjects. So hyperconjugation is its own thing. We do have YouTube lectures on that, but we're looking at real conjugation of pi electrons here today. So this is important because the delocalization of the pi electrons is going to result in lower energy. And lower energy is going to be important when we're looking at pi to pi star or bonding to antibonding transitions when we're talking about excitation of electrons. And that's what UV-Vis spectroscopy is used for. So as I lower that energy gap, that's going to be important in determining wavelength when I'm looking at, you know, a lambda max or the maximum wavelength that's going to excite the electron up into a LUMO orbital. And we'll discuss some of that in a minute here. All right, so for example, 1,3-butadiene, and we're going to use this example quite a bit in this lecture here. I've got a compound that looks like this, and then I have 4 p orbitals, right? I have one at each of the pi nodes. So when you're looking at this, you've got 4 of the p orbitals here, and how many pi electrons do you have? Well, you've got 2 pi bonds, and if you have 2 pi bonds, a bond is made up of 2 electrons, so you really have 4 pi electrons. And this is important because we also have 4 p orbitals when we're dealing with this. So this is going to sort of carry over into atomic orbitals being represented as molecular orbitals. So you may have heard of MO theory. We're not going to give a huge breakdown on what that is here today. However, when you deal with molecular orbitals, that's when we start talking about this pi bonding, antibonding sort of stuff. So when you have atomic orbitals, you can represent these as molecular orbitals. So these p orbitals can be represented as molecular orbitals. You can call them pi molecular orbitals. A lot of times they use the symbol psi, which looks like this. Okay, the p orbitals are represented as psi molecular orbitals. You have a bonding and an antibonding region. So let's consider the following regions. We've got 1-butene and 1,3-butadiene. So let's take a look at these two. 1-butene is going to have a terminal double bond like that, and then the 1,3-butadiene, which we've been using, we know that that looks like this. All right, now if I were to consider the p orbitals here, I'd have 2 of them right here, right? Now, remember, with sigma bonds, you can have sigma bonding involved in your molecular orbitals, but we're just going to be looking at the pi bonding and the conjugation with the p orbitals in this example today. However, there are no p orbitals that are found at these two positions, because this is sp3 right here, and this is also sp3, right? sp3 hybridized. There's no p orbitals left behind because there's no pi electrons or resonance formation going on right there. So if we were to take a look at that and we were to label it, we could say that we've got pi and then pi star in terms of molecular orbitals, right? And then you divide right in between the line here, and this would be the bonding region. Again, this assumes that you have some small background in MO theory, and this is going to be what's called the antibonding region. Now, if you were to ever have a molecular orbital that falls right in the middle, let's say I had three here, then you can also have a non-bonding region. And a non-bonding region is not as low in energy as the bonding, but it's not as high in energy as the antibonding. So just keep that in mind. But if you have an even split, your lower level are the bonding, your higher level are the antibonding. Now keep in mind, as we're going along here, we've got energy, right? Now how many electrons are in this pi bond? There's two of them. So I would draw two pi electrons in the pi bonding. You always fill the bonding first, and then you move up, because you would fill the lower energy orbitals. That goes into anytime we're doing our SPD filling of the shells, right? We always go for the lowest energy first, which is closest to the nucleus. So when we get ready to take a look at this, if I wanted to excite one of these electrons into the antibonding region, it's going to require a certain wavelength. So my lambda, there's going to be a delta E requirement here, and the gap in energy needs to be met exactly by a certain wavelength in order to excite one of these pi electrons up to the pi star or the antibonding, and then it would come back down after you stop hitting it with that wavelength. All right, so that's how this general concept works. Now, what's important here in reference to conjugation is that as I get into conjugation, first of all, I'm going to have more, right? So I have four p orbitals, as we discussed before, right here. And when I have that, I'm going to look at 1, 2, and then here comes the dashed line, 3, 4, all right? Now, what's important here, I have the four pi electrons, but what I really want you to take away from this is that the delta E between the bonding and the antibonding right here is going to be smaller. Okay. So, in other words, these get closer together, conjugation lowers the energy, and therefore the delta E jump is smaller for the bonding to antibonding jump. So here's our bonding down here, and here's the anti region up here again. This gap has been closed a little bit because of the conjugation lowering the energy requirements. So that means that we're going to have a different wavelength that is required in order to excite the 1,3-butadiene in comparison to the 1-butene, right? And if I continue to extend my conjugation further and further, I'm going to see this effect continue. I'm going to squash the delta E until it becomes very, very small. So I just also want to note here, open chain systems like we're working with right now are slightly different than aromatic systems that are circular and more flat in terms of the planar. So just keep that in mind, that it doesn't translate one-to-one if I were to take 1,3-butadiene and then compare benzene, for instance, and look at the energy gaps between those. All right. Now, when we are looking at this, it's important to consider there is an equation for energy and it relates it to wavelength. So we can write this as energy is going to be equal to Planck's constant times the speed of light over wavelength. Now, what you want to take away from this is that we have energy is inversely proportional to wavelength. All right. So by the relationship of this equation, what we can say is as conjugation increases, conjugation goes up, the delta E comes down. And if energy is inversely related to the delta E, right? I'm sorry, if energy is inversely related to the wavelength, then the wavelength must go up if delta E is going down. So that means as conjugation goes up, the wavelength for exciting the molecule goes up, as in its energy goes down. That's the relationship here. So what we can expect is as we get to higher and higher wavelengths in nanometers, we're going to start branching from the UV part of the spectrum into the visible part of the spectrum. And that's why things that have very, very large conjugated systems, and we'll take a look at this with beta carotene, you're going to start getting into the visible region as you start getting higher. And that's why we see that orange looking color from the molecule. Now, that does not mean that it absorbs orange energy. Okay, it actually is probably going to absorb a violet blue energy, and then it is going to reflect the opposite on the color spectrum if you ever made that color wheel. So one last thing I want to mention here, the terminology, when you have the highest occupied molecular orbital that are occupied by electrons, we refer to that, you may have heard it as the HOMO orbital. And then you also have the LUMO orbital, which is the lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. And electron transitions are going to occur from the HOMO to the LUMO. That's the goal when we're doing this UV-Vis. That's the smallest energy jump you can get for the excitation. And it requires a very specific wavelength because it requires a very specific delta E jump. So this is all sort of quantum mechanics where we have discrete energy that is required. It's not just a continuous scale, but there's a very specific set amount of energy required for an electron to be excited to the next orbital. All right, so hopefully all of that makes sense, and you can now put together the following concept. So as conjugation is increased, the energy jump between the HOMO and the LUMO is going to be decreased, and therefore the wavelength must become larger in order to excite. This is an inverse relationship that we just saw from that equation. So take a look at the following. We talked about 1-butene. That would take 174 nanometers in order to excite. And then 1,3-butadiene would be 217 nanometers. 1,3,5-hexatriene. So what I'm just doing here is I'm continuing to extend the conjugation by an extra double bond, single bond here, right? So 258. And then the 1,3,5,7-octatetraene is going to be 290. So you can see it climbing as we continue to rack up and add this here. And then look at beta carotene down here. You've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 pi bonds that are conjugated. All right, now that is quite a bit coming from the 3 for the triene and the 4, right, for the octatetraene. So when we get to beta carotene, it gets all the way up to 455 nanometers. That's a pretty big jump. And what we see is the UV region, which humans cannot see with their eye, is going to be between 10 to 400 nanometers. And then the visible region, it is just shy of 400. These are approximations. It's around 380, 385. But 400 to 750 is the general accepted range for visible light, with the 400 being the near UV. So you hear of ultraviolet. We're starting to cross into the violet territory around 380, 390. And then we move all the way up to the red when we get to 750. And then you have infrared. And that would come after that, which would be lower in energy. All right. So when we take a look at this, the beta carotene is able to cross over into the visible region, and it is absorbing visible light. It would be specifically looking towards the lower end of the visible spectrum in terms of what it's absorbing, and then it's reflecting back what you would see towards the higher end, which is what gives it that color. So this pretty much wraps up what I wanted to talk about, but hopefully you now have an understanding of the relationship with conjugation. As conjugation continues to further the delocalization and expand the p-orbital overlap, all right, you're going to end up with lower and lower and lower delta E's, that energy requirement is going to be suppressed into very, very tiny jumps. It won't require a whole lot. And because we have this inverse relationship where the energy right here and the wavelength are inversely related, that means the wavelength will continue to climb and climb and climb as we're dealing with these highly conjugated systems. So that pretty much wraps up conjugation and UV-Vis spectroscopy. I may get further into some of the details of UV-Vis and do more of an extended, almost a graduate level type of look at different functional groups and how they can affect the jump in UV-Vis. So what happens when we add carbonyl groups or things like that. So if you found this helpful, please remember to like the video. You can always comment and I'll try to get back to you. And if you subscribe and hit the bell, you'll get all the latest updates whenever we release content. We're ramping up for the school year with it being August, so get ready for that. And other than that, I hope everybody has a great day. And go check us out at chemcomplete.com. We've got free resources there. We've got some very, very helpful guides I've put together, very long, detailed guides that you can purchase to help support the channel. We are on Patreon, and you can also get a hold of us for one-on-one mentoring and tutoring for the school year. So best of luck to everybody with your studies, and I will see you for the next lecture.